I'll tell you a story if you want to hear a story.
And we don't want to hear a story that's going to last all week.
Nope, it won't. But this is the God's truth.
We came here because we're opposed to the murder of Vietnamese and to the murder of black Americans and all the other Americans who are subject to the draft.
Say the truth! Say the truth!
I mean, what are the cops going to do?
After going to Washington, D.C. for a while and thinking, boy, it's going to be a long time before all these people retire and get out of here and something changes, so I don't think I can stand to wait around.
We thought the government was going to be overthrown in 2 years and there would be a new culture rising from the ashes, and we wanted to have an alternative, a non-mercantile alternative that offered citizens the options of being something other than a consumer or an employee.
I moved there to get away from America. I just did not want to be an American as defined by the mainstream. Although, I guess deep down, I've always felt, you know, that proud that I'm an American. But to me, those values are represented in open-mindedness and free thinking and tolerance and the ability to do what you want.
That's an old one.
Hey, how do you tell when this tank
is this going?
Is it? Yeah. Wait a minute. Is the red light on?
Yeah, I don't. We know what I'm
doing. Hey.
Far out. Far out.
It was shocking. Where you've never been around a commune in your life. Then walk right into the middle of it. So, what can you say? It was shocking.
Okay, let's go. One Hildegard of the Wet Feet. The Wet Feet variety.
I had this vision, and you know, I suppose I was pretty pompous about it, but it was basically, we're going to go and change the world. My slogan at the time was free land for free people. We were going on a camping trip, and I said, stop. I want to go into that realty company. I like the name of it because the name was Big Sky Realty. And so I went in and I told them what I wanted. And the man went to a filing cabinet and plucked out a file and handed it to me. And it said Black Bear Ranch. And I said, oh, this looks very interesting.
The big problem is we didn't have any money. So a number of us decided to go down to L.A. and knock on the doors of various rock and roll groups, including Frank Zappa and the Monkees, and let them know that, hey, listen, you're making money off of our lifestyle, and it's time that you give back some to us.
People were really excited and listening to us and whatnot. We're saying, well, it's this and it's that, and it's just gorgeous.
Amongst our many friends there, there was James Coburn and his wife, and he let us into his house, and we smoked pot together on the couch. We enjoyed his company and all that stuff, but we needed money so we could get back and get this land rolling. And I decided I was going to give him an experience of what it means to have an encounter with a provocateur. He was in bed with his wife. In the meantime, I poured all this gasoline and kerosene into his fountain, and I draped the American flag across the top of it, and then I called all the servants to stand around the fountain, and I said, now go up and get Jim. As soon as Jim came down, I was singing the Star Spangled Banner, and I flipped a match into the fountain, and the whole thing lit up, and the servants, who were all smiling at first, their faces dropped. and Jim just totally went ballistic. Jim, if you hear this, I want to tell you I'm really, really sorry. I know I told you this before, but, you know, those are crazy times.
It's hard for people to imagine today how poised on the brink of change things were. A lot of people were choosing to fight the government politically, but we saw the problem as culture, and we tried to create living possibilities of an alternative culture that we hoped, when push came to shove, people would defend. Our communal families were spread from San Francisco all the way north along the coast. But by the time you got to Black Bear, you were at the end of a 9-mile-long dirt road that ended at Black Bear. It was incredibly isolated.
Don't take all those shots where I don't look like, or I look like I don't know what the hell I'm doing. Okay? Don't have it just be a whole tape of a guy, a confused old guy who don't know what the fuck he's doing. Some of us thought it was a good idea to start a place out in the mountains for our city warriors to rest up, learn skills from which we would make forays down into the cities. After all, Castro had done it just a few years before.
All messages have been played.
Good. I wanted blood brothers who would cover my back the way I would cover theirs when the shit hit the fan, as it was going to. I was already older than most of these guys. I was in my mid-30s. I was a grown-up.
We were expecting to have 12 people there the first winter, and by the time Richard and I got back to the ranch, there was no place for us to live. There was 40 people there.
There were like 100 people there. I remember I said to one guy, how'd you get here? He says, well, I worked in a gas station on 99, and this guy, Michael, stopped in and told me, come on up, free land for free people. So I quit my job and I came up.
Richard was a trade labor union organizer in New York City. He found this old military costume up in the attic. He got a blackboard and a pointer to organize the ranch. No one took him seriously, and by the next morning, the blackboard and pointer and the military costume had totally disappeared, never to be seen again. And so that was our first indication that we were working with a group of anarchists here.
See, what are... You know, nothing's going to happen with these people. I can turn around right now and leave, or I can decide that maybe I had something to learn here.
Local law enforcement, of course, thought there was an invasion of flower children and druggies and all kinds of things.
Quite frankly, it was any drugs that ever came up there got used so fast that usually they were there wasn't any around.
Everybody thinks that everything that they grew over there was for drugs.
Saw a garden growing, and the narcotics expert from the sheriff's office says, yep, that's it. That's their marijuana garden.
The sheriff in Yreka decided he was going to do an early morning raid, knocked on the door, busted it in, went into the gardens and all this stuff. One guy says back, yeah, I think that tomato, yeah, I'm not sure, it looked like pot plants to me.
And sure enough, they pulled up, I don't know how many plants, but a large number of plants, and brought them into Yreka and got the press in to issue a photograph with a new narcotics officer. And the interesting thing about all this is not marijuana, there are tomato plants.
Beautiful up there in the summertime. But boy, in the wintertime, that is a son of a gun. If you got a four-wheel drive, that don't mean nothing. You just be stuck someplace else,
That winter was the first winter in a long time that the locals had seen 6 feet of snow. And we had a young infant. We were running out of food. I was pregnant. It was really our crucible. Mark built a pair of snowshoes and walked 10 miles over the mountains to go and get us kerosene and matches, because we were that desperate. I mean, I was thinking Donner Party.
And it was this buzz out there, oh, the hippies up there, they'll never make it, they'll never make it.
Your choices were real clear, either do it or you're gonna freeze to death. Either do it or you're not gonna eat. In other words, it wasn't like all these theoretical, philosophical, you could do that if you wanted to. But basically, chop wood, haul water, cook food, or become a dead Zen guy, wonderful stuff. But frankly, it was a very, you know, we had to be very, very practical.
Yeah, so that first winter was, we were snowed in. We were really, and I feel like that was better than anything I could have planned or thought up, because it just happened. And there I was with a bunch of beautiful young people. Several of them learned how to work to provide. And we made music, you know. We read stories to children, made up stories. Christmas, we made toys, you know. Chop down a tree and make a toy, give it to a kid.
Here, actually, you want to hold this water jug? Traipsing around with my water jug. I'm a water addict, as if you can't tell. My first exposure to black bear was when Michael Tierra and Glenn and Richard Marley came through the Jelly Roll Press. These guys were a trip. They smelled and looked like billy goats or something. They weren't like, you know, hippies with Hate Street beads. I mean, they were wearing these animal skins and big knives and boots, and was like, whoa, these guys are the real deal. So they said, well, why don't you come visit? I was really scared and lonely. That draft was breathing down my neck. When I came to Black Bear, I found that acceptance and that love. And it felt like I'd come home, and I was just like a puppy.
When I got to Black Bear, most of the women were in long skirts and very much with and for and sort of devoted to their man.
Everybody that was male had a Bowie knife attached onto their sides. So there was that kind of, you know, we're from the Wild West, you know, we're going to conquer the land. Very Western attitude to embracing the earth. And then there were the women who, you know, supported this, really, basically, and truly supported these fantasies because they were collecting welfare checks.
A lot of us women, we wanted to learn to do some of the kinds of things that guys usually did, like making shakes or cutting wood or, you know, we were kind of in the macho single women group.
I knew then that Mahaj was my mate. At some point, it became really clear that she was my mate, a soul mate. I told her, but she didn't really quite get it right then and there.
We were erecting a dome, and they were working with us. Women had never worked with the men. The men always did the erecting, the erecting. The building of the dome. So these women wanted to work, and to me it seemed silly. I mean, it really seemed silly.
It looked like little dwarf land. A little house built up in a tree over here. Nothing over there. I mean, they're city people. And I tried to help them. The guys didn't like to be bossed around, and they didn't know nothing. So I got the ladies to go to work with me, cut wood. And it was kind of neat.
When I allowed those concepts to come in and I looked at the reality and really did look, and not just all my old assumptions and, you know, male privilege and all that, which I took for granted, and you couldn't hear the women. Suddenly I started listening, and I saw it, especially maybe being the father of a daughter. I had to look at it differently.
The women that had been most sort of submissive became the most fiercely powerful.
All the women started working with the men. And, you know, I remember the first time a group of women went out with chainsaws to cut wood, but it just seemed totally natural.
Okay. Nice to see you this morning.
Nice to see you.
Growing up in the suburbs of New York City in Westport, Connecticut, I never felt comfortable. I felt as if it wasn't really who I was. I was politically active, and as a result of my activities in the city, the FBI was closely following my whereabouts. In the middle of the night, I went to support the Black brothers and sisters at the Black Panther Party headquarters, because if white kids like me weren't there, there was a danger that they would be attacked by the police, who were actually executing people like them. So because of the intensity of my involvement, and because I was friendly with people who had become part of the Weather Underground, I felt as if I had two choices: to go underground myself or to get out of town. So I ended up opting to get out of town, and going to Black Bear was about as far out of town as you could get.
Spleen 4, kidney 3, and 5, 8, and 3 liter 5.
FBI came bringing ice cream for the kids. They were looking for Patricia Hearst and Bernadine Dorn, and of course the kids liked ice cream, but these people weren't hiding at Black Bear, and the kids somehow knew enough not to talk to them anyway.
There wasn't anything unusual, really, about what we were doing. What we were doing was what everyone else was doing, except we were doing it together in this one spot. And that's what people were looking for. They were looking for some kind of intense way in which they could relate to other people. When people came in from the outside, very often they'd come in knowing where they were going. And then we had a guy from one of the local towns. He came in. We were sure that he was from the FBI and the CIA, and that he was a plant. But he fit in very well also for a while. I mean, he was, you know, it's very pleasant. We just thought of him as being the guy from the CIA.
We'd have long discussions about whether to buy toilet paper or do without, whether coffee was an imperial food or whether it wasn't.
Everyone needed to come together, live together, sleep together, eat together, piss together, whatever. Everything had to be done together to unite people.
The most archetypical Black Bear story I know was walking out one morning to gather wild mushrooms and walking down past the milk cow, which was the source of yogurt and milk and cream and everything for the farm.
We were milking this cow, and some of us had
fallen in love with the cow, and we were into nurturing the cow. We were milking the cow. And some people were really backed up, and cows represented a whole bunch of stuff. And there was goat people, and there was a lot of angles. So we had this meeting because it became a crisis, how to deal with the cow. And the cow was staked right outside the main house and could hear our conversation. Some people were saying, we should butcher it and have a big party. We should eat it and have a big party. And other people were saying, no, we're milking it, and it's giving us this milk. And other people saying, goat's milk is so much healthier, cow's milk is bad. And other people were saying, well, maybe we could breed it and have beef cows and grow beef for ourselves. Basically, it was like, the vote was like 80-20, eat it, 20, preserve, keep it alive. And when we walked out, it had fallen, and because it was chained by the neck, and it fell off this little embankment, and it broke its neck and was dead.
I felt like I'd created a monster here, you know, and suddenly these people were turning on me and saying, you can't make art because it's not communal enough. You know, it's too individualistic, and you have to, and you must be, you know, I think Ephraim told me that I was obsessed, you know, and that this was bad, you know, and that I needed psychoanalytical treatments for this obsession that I had.
There were a lot of people who were there because they were socialists, and there were people there because they were just artists, and they were gardeners, and back to nature. And you know, one of the funny things is that we never bothered to ask each other why we were there. We just assumed we were all there for the same reason, which must have been the reason I was there for.
Do you have any calcium pills for her? She has a headache that's stubborn.
Tierra, I think of Tierra coming into the living room at Black Bear after practicing the piano for a couple of hours in a quilted robe and asking for his breakfast.
Huh? You ever take calcium pills for headache?
No. Toothpaste. You should be behind us, is where you should be. he's adjusting my back.
I began to just spend a lot of time going through books and all the herbs that we had brought from San Francisco at the time to figure out how to use these things. And every time anybody got sick, you know, I'd go out and pick something or do something and try it out on them. And I think there were a lot of vomiting and retching that went on in my early years of trying to sort all this out.
I remember at one point I said, why are you going to heal those people in Santa Cruz for? I mean, they got money, doctors, how about here in West Oakland, you know? They need healing there. And his answer was, and I guess, I don't know if I forgive him, but I accept it. I don't hold it against him. But his answer was, the people in Santa Cruz are on a higher level. They're evolved. Their spiritual incarnations is at a place where they can receive and function on this level. Like the black people down in West Oakland, you know, they were bleeding and killing each other, and they don't want to have anything to do with that. And I have that question about several of the healers in our family. You know, how come you're healing rich people? I remember when I was a kid, you'd go to a movie made in the 30s, right? And there'd be the movie would start. Someone with the society broad would go. A guy would go to the doctor and say, "Oh, you need a long vacation in the Bahamas." And whoop, they're in the Bahamas, and they're running. I never met anybody who got sick like that.
It began for us when one of our brothers quite rightly lowered an American flag to half-mast. No one since then has mentioned the rightness of his act. It followed with an unprovoked charge of the pig into our space.
My parents came here fleeing Hitler.
because I grew up in a house of intellectuals. My father wrote one of the seminal books on Nazi Germany. My stepfather was Herbert Marcuse, who was a philosopher. I was a part of this group called the Motherfuckers. It was a anarchist street gang that was on the Lower East Side. We were constantly sort of at war with the cops. Being in the Motherfuckers was stressful. I mean, it was not easy to relax in the Motherfuckers. I was never a very manly man. You know, I was always somewhat as a fraud as a man. But I was in a scene, the Motherfuckers was a scene that very much was about men and male bonding and how men are together and how they deal with their fear and how they overcome fear and loyalty. And when I went to Black Bear, we were not hidden from each other. I didn't have to always prove something. Just felt like coming home.
Hey, Os.
Where are you?
Down here.
How you doing?
All right, how you doing?
Good. Nice burger.
So you want a big pot?
Yeah. Good thing it's got.
How do you like this shirt? I got that at Nomadic Traders. They had the sale.
Nomadic Traders?
Yeah. I got six of them. Come on, we're gonna wash the house laundry. How do you like the hydrangeas?
Huh?
I was class president in high school. At the time, my name was Ken, and my girlfriend's name was Barbie. She was a cheerleader from Tamil Pius High School, and I graduated from Santa Fe High School. And I was a teenage Republican. And halfway through my senior year, I had a little identity crisis. I was living in Berkeley, and I got a letter from Morningstar and Gaba, I think, who said, well, we've had a feminist revolution at Black Bear. It's safe to come up. Looks like I'm not going to be able to do the laundry. Somebody's already in there. But you want a pot. Let's go see if we can find you a pot. So did you bring me some plums?
I will. They're all on the tree.
Okay.
You want me to pick them?
I thought you already took them off the tree.
I can bring some a jar of the plums that I jarred.
I'd rather come over and eat fresh plums. There were a bunch of communes around that meditated all the time or had gurus and did all kinds of important higher level spiritual stuff. And walked around loving each other constantly and smiling at each other and holding each other. And we all thought they were kind of weird.
And here's a self-portrait. Yeah, and actually one other self-portrait. There we go.
Peterleaf is the archetype of the unfulfilled, unhappy artist who can't connect with the world.
You don't get to say that. Say something else about Peterleaf.
I don't get to say that.
No.
Peter is also a tremendously creative and brilliant person, and was one of the...
Well, don't say also, because you didn't say the other thing. Peterleaf is...
Why don't you say what you want to say about Peter?
I want you to, but I don't want it to be negative, and it doesn't work to say is also, because this is the only thing you're saying. Well,
Peter is a frustrated man, and he was a very creative man, And he struggled mightily at Black Bear to make a place for himself and to be creative. And
you don't get to say Peter's frustrated.
Let me say again that Peter Leaf was a very brilliant and creative man. He was a painter, and he was actually one of the people that inspired me to go to Black Bear in the first place.
This is the main house at Black Bear.
Here's Catherine.
We had this Red Brigade that went around, some people from the ranch that called themselves the Red Brigade, and they asked the question, what are we all doing here together? We're all living in cabins out in the woods, and why are we here? Let's live together, really live together.
Everyone's clothes were put up on big racks in the middle of the room, and you just got dressed every day in whatever you took off a rack. Or no one was allowed to sleep with anyone more than two nights in a row because that would promote couples, and couples were a bourgeois decadence. I was never much for the chaotic or the unaesthetic aspects of communes. I've always appreciated refinement. But when I got to Black Bear, I was just struck by the beauty of it. There was a creek, there were meadows, there were fields, and there were cute women there. What more could you want?
Finally, one woman said, let's just have an orgy tonight. Well, none of us ever was in an orgy. We didn't even know what it was. and the humor of it really was that immediately everybody said yes, and when nobody knew what they were saying yes to.
I could love my lover loving someone else. I could see that. I wasn't necessarily a threatening situation for me personally.
You could explore any level of relationship with anyone who was willing to explore that with you too.
A lot of times I didn't dress. They got up and run without dresses or without pants on. So what? It just, you didn't, where you've never been around something like that, it's hard to visualize, and it's hard to turn around and tell you what went on.
The most memorable relationship I had at Black Bear was with Catherine, and Catherine was a total free soul from Chicago. We lived together in one of the cabins. I was walking up to the cabin, was illuminated from within by this wonderful light. It was a kind of three or four kerosene lamps, and it was a beautiful evening. The sun had just set. The stars were beginning to come out. And as I looked over, framed in the two doors was Catherine naked with some other man whose name I forget. Terrible that I forget his name. But they were standing embracing. And as when I first looked at it, I thought, what a beautiful picture, and then suddenly it hit me that it was Catherine, and I just totally flipped out.
Yes, we had, he was wonderful, and there were loves that I felt definitely with various people, with Peter, with Glenn. I had loves at the ranch, definitely. What I'm speaking to is not not that, but the more the just anything goes anytime with anyone. And the game around it, like who's sleeping with who tonight, and all the pain that we all had to go through with.
Usually, someplace or another, there's murder over the orange juice. You know, your old lady comes back with having spent the night with somebody else, and you're drinking orange juice in the morning, and she'll spill the orange juice, and somebody's stupid bitch, you know, and it's got nothing to do with the orange juice. It's got to do with jealousy.
There was something not exactly deeply fulfilling about just having sexual relationships, that just having sex in itself wasn't necessarily deeply rewarding. When we both realized and acknowledged that, that's when we became a couple, which kind of bucked the trend at the ranch at that time. But we came together for reasons that were based on, they weren't based on need, they were based on choice. And that made it powerful.
In the middle of the night, a young woman climbed into bed with me and fucked me upside and down. And I woke up in the morning and my bed was empty. And so I went downstairs, for breakfast, and all the girls were sitting there eating the eggs, you know, chopping up the onions, you know, making the big omelet for the. And I figured, well, I'll be able to, you know, as soon as I see the women there, I'll be able to tell which one it was. Well, I couldn't. They all looked at me like that. I'll never forget that night. It was a great night. And not the sex so much, but just the, I want to cry. The open-heartedness of it.
It's a stupid thing my parents did when I was a kid. No, I'm just kidding. What is free love? I don't know. I think it's an ideal. I grew up extremely open-minded in terms of what relationships look like, whether, you know, even down to the point of like, well, should relationships be with a man or with a woman? And it's been a pretty permeable boundary for me. Like, I really fall in love with people. And I think the reason that I was able to do that was because that was the ideal I was raised with. Now, I found that it's a little harder for my family to muster, because even though they they instilled in me the value to be very open and just, you know, really go with what felt right to me. They were raised in the 50s by, like, very traditional families, and I have hit a little bit of that.
I came to Black Bear because a friend of mine was having a baby. Harriet and I are best friends from when we were children growing up in the same town. You know, we fantasized about living in the country and living together. Having a place where we had gardens and we, you know, raised kids and lived communally.
We were on our own. There wasn't a clinic that we could go to. The nearest hospital was 3 hours away.
Women who were here then started training to become midwives. You know, we took a lot of chances in a way. We were, you know, mostly self-trained midwives, a group of lay midwives.
I summoned up my courage and went and studied up on how to deliver a child and what to do in case of hemorrhages and stuff like that.
So there was, you know, babies born in teepees, outside, in the various structures around the ranch. It wasn't just going to a place where you birthed and then you went home and you were alone. We birthed and then we continued to be there for each other in every aspect, for, you know, for the coming in of the milk and the first nursing and changing of the diapers and taking our children into the sweat for the first time as little infants, as babies, as a sort of an initiation.
You know, we had a lot of children. There were a lot of dirty diapers. And when you see a bucket of shitty diapers, I mean, it takes a strong stomach.
Oh.
mother went into labor actually in the middle of a meeting about my birth. She went and lay down on the summer bed, and I came so quick that she just had me there. My mother is Gaba. I feel like she was the universal mother at Black Bear. We weren't limited to just our one little nuclear family. There was so many different people to bounce off of, and when it got too intense between us, you know, there was always somebody else. And I don't know, I feel like I had a lot of mothers growing up. This is my crazy little bus. I've been living in here since I was 13. It was like my step of independence. Cool. This is the Cobb house. I've been building this house for almost 3 years now. Probably 100 people's hands have gone into this. All of my life, that's been an incredible thing, just the freedom that I've been permitted. There's no fear.
Allegra is this shining star. She encompasses all the good that came from my experience of living at Black Bear. A child who was born into unconditional love from the whole ranch, as well as her personal family. She is a total free spirit, a shining, glowing, inspiring person.
Says, do not duplicate. Oh, it's 20. Oh, okay. That a kickback? That ain't my kickback. That's a 20 I lent you.
Why not?
We haven't talked about the kickback yet, have we?
That's 400 extra, you know.
Okay. I'll bring you a wrench and a cheese.
A Zen teacher said, life is like a little boat, and you sail it out onto the big ocean, and it sinks. That's it. I mean, the happy ending was 5 million times as you were sailing out. So I was told I have so much time to live, you know, so I'm making, can you get that? I haven't read it, but I like, you know, the title is enough to get me going. I find that, I wish I had known I was dying 50 years ago because, you know, I might have paid more attention to some of the things that I've kind of brushed aside, you know.
The kids' life was separate from the adults. You know, we were like a tribe. So we would just wander into the different gardens, you know, and play a lot on these secret trails that we had. Certain trails were A and B and B1, and this one intersected with this trail on this side of the mountain. We would just kind of wander like, you know, a bunch of the goats or something like that. The goats would be wandering around, and we'd be wandering around, and we had our own society, basically. You don't want to shoot this because it's going to look like a mess, because it's nothing to do with, actually. It's just, I'm just trying to get a sample that we can look at. The kids, I think, maybe have a feeling that they were a little bit like lab rats, you know? They were experimental tools for,
we're going to go upstairs.
For the parents. They're just so engrossed in their ideas, you know, about how to live, and so conscious about how to live, you know, that the other people around them who depended on them, they weren't necessarily a big part of their thoughts. I decided I want to be just like the logger kids who grew up around there. So to kind of adjust and rebel at the same time, you know, I decided that I'd get a crew cut.
Elsa left her kids to live with us, and we were raising them and living with them. And Aaron hated being a hippie and hated living with us and wanted to go live with Rachel, who was a local Indian woman. And he just bitched and complained and complained and complained. So one day we said, so, okay, go live with Rachel. That's what you want to do.
Cannoli and I hated each other. The whole time we were at the ranch, it was like, he didn't have kids and he didn't really understand what people with kids were struggling with, or, you know, and his attitude about kids I thought was very peculiar and regimented by ideas, not by, you know, warmth.
So he went to live with Rachel and Elsa, found out about it and got totally livid and showed up. She called Richard up wherever he was living and got him to show up. And the two of them showed up and reestablished the Marley family down at Indian Creek and brought their kids back together. And I was pretty angry with her for doing that, because I felt that when it was convenient for her to run off and do her art thing in the city, she was fine to leave her kids with us.
And we're close again now. Aaron and I. Not close, but he's Marley. I'm his father. And, you know, we're still working on it. We'll always work on it.
Even now, I've kind of learned to always keep my distance a little bit with him. But just because I've been, you know, on the upside and the downside many times with Richard.
Yeah. But I've always thought Black Bear is a beautiful place in the world, but if I could just get it together.
Once you have a baby that's waking up at 6 a.m, you may not want to hear, you know, your 5 friends out there in Wino Tom Tom Land at 4 a.m. keeping you up. And those kind of strictures and disciplines forced us to get more orderly. A lot of nuclear families, when they had children, moved out of the communes.
If you live with other people, you're basically going to experience a certain amount of frustration. If you don't come up with some way of dealing with that frustration, maybe by being completely candid or honest or finding some nonviolent way to work out how to deal with these tensions within the group, then the group basically implodes.
Some people left gracefully, other people it was just this painful tearing apart, other people had anger. It was just, it's never an easy thing to do for virtually anyone.
Eventually people went out to fulfill themselves as individuals, sometimes as a couple, sometimes as a couple that then split, sometimes that as individuals that then became a couple, but to fulfill themselves, they had to leave Black Bear.
I told Cedar, well, I don't want to have communal children. You know, I want to have more connection with them, and, you know, I want them to have more in their life than what we can offer them here. So we're going to have to get jobs, you know?
Then we managed to save, and we bought a piece of land close to the ranch. And so we were able to live there and build a home, and our kids were born at home with the loving presence of ranch women and friends and loved ones. They were blessed with a boy and girl, both so free in a troubled world. So it goes every day. They've been together now all the way, so high. One more time again, let's fly with our hearts always entwined. My love and I will fly.
begin with.
It's true song.
The Shivalila were a group of people traveling around the world trying to find the perfect place to raise children. The perfect place, the perfect culture. They really felt like the American way of life was very flawed.
You know, they kind of looked and walked and talked like your average cult. They had this guy that everybody, you know, that was the guru, and everybody lived their lives according to what he said. And they saw themselves as being kind of above the rest of the world and just told the rest of us what they were going to do instead of, you know, connecting with us, working with us and stuff. And it was kind of gridly with a bunch of women that followed him around.
You see, part of my trip is that I don't have any children. I don't have any family that is mine. And everybody I'm with is me.
Supposedly those women were into working around sexuality, but none of them ever made love with me. And they decided they were going to live at the ranch, essentially decided they were going to take over the ranch, and the ranch was going to be their scene.
The input that I got from the Black Bear people was that this was a negative force, that this degree of honesty, this degree of encounter was somehow not... It wasn't right on. There was something necromantic or I'm not quite sure what the word is for it.
They took a lot of acid, and they were really into children, and their practice was to drop acid and hang out with the baby.
When people look at me, they just see a reflection of themselves, because I'm there saying, here, now, nothing, 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 nothing. No, about the only desire I could have would be that the whole world would go crazy, because then it'd finally be safe for me and the kids.
We like to think of ourselves as the outlaws of the outlaws. You know, we like to think of ourselves as the Jesse James that rode down out of the mountains and made raids on the other groups. But actually, you know, we were really looking for people of like mind who wanted to join us and expand this reality that we were in.
One of the things they did with Indira when she was, you know, just a young girl in puberty, just beginning puberty, and she had, you know, somebody had given her this little bikini bathing suit that she was very proud of, and she was wearing it. I mean, everybody at Black Bear in the summer went around naked anyway, but, you know, she had this cute little bathing suit to wear, so she was into that. And one of the Shivalila women ripped it off of her and destroyed it, because she was doing something that was sexist.
There could be an incident with five people and just like, you know, brush them on. You're gonna get five different viewpoints. But this is the viewpoint of the day that Shivalila decided to leave Black Bear.
Things weren't taking care of themselves, and they were infiltrating more and more into, you know, young people.
It became evident what was the appropriate direction to go in.
All of a sudden, all these cars are coming down the mountain, and it was like everybody, and I said, I didn't realize there was going to be a party today.
We mobilized our force.
100 people showed up from the city and from the ranch, I mean, from the river, and just stood there and yelled at them and told them they had to leave.
You can't live at Black Bear.
I sort of noticed activity going to the summer kitchen. Oh, I figured, oh, they're going to the summer kitchen, and then somebody came down and said that they wanted to talk to us. I said, oh, okay.
Shivalila had to go.
They could not. This is not their home.
You have to go someplace else. Black Bear is a free space, but you're not free enough to deserve to be here. So you have to leave.
I'm like, well, you know, we don't have any money. We don't have anywhere to go. And it was getting really, really tense. It was really tense.
But it was like originally free land for free people. I mean, nobody that lived there paid for the money. The money was collected from rock stars and other people.
They gathered together with some of our people here and got it together to leave the country, to go to the Philippines and then to India.
Being 5 years old and being given the option to choose between staying at Black Bear and going with the Shivalila, for me at the time, it was just, I think I wanted to be with my mother. But I didn't realize that a huge part of the group was breaking the bond between mother and child. They sent me to live with this family in the Philippines, up in this tree house, and it's this whole family. We didn't speak the same language. I was crying for like the first amount of time, just kicking and screaming. When I was in India living with these families, the families would say, the Shiva Lila who brought you here, who were like the only family I knew, went back to the United States. A lot of the kids were really young. It's actually kind of sad. I'll try not to do it without crying. It might not work. When we went from the Philippines to India, I don't remember the name of the village, but we ended up in a village where there was an epidemic, I think diphtheria, and a lot of the young kids got sick, and I don't know how many, but a good portion of the kids died.
There's nothing you can do to prepare for that. It's just a devastating experience. And even after all these years, I still, you know, even discussing this brings up an incredible amount of grief for me. It's like there's a hole that's ripped in my reality.
Wanting to save the world can be a huge ego trip. It's just another bullshit thing.
We ended up leaving India, and we traveled through Mexico. I think we were in Canada for a while. It's all not very clear. We were in Oregon, in Ashland, I believe, and there was this girl, Milagra, who I don't know if you've heard about, but she's one of the Black Bear kids, and she happened to live in that town, and her house was right down the street from where the Shiva Lila group was staying, and she saw me and recognized me.
She wrote me a letter and sent me to Celia's letter, because she was trying to teach Cecilia an alphabet, how to write, so she taught her how to write me a letter. Cecilia wrote me a letter, and it was the first time I knew they had come back.
So that was kind of, she planted this little seed. She played me the Paul Simon and Garfunkel song, Cecilia, You're Breaking My Heart, Come On Home.
Meredith and a couple other people had gotten a contract for cone picking, and it was in the Salmon River area. So she came back to pick cones, and she brought Cecilia with her.
And so it just kind of got something going in my head, and we ran into some like sister people, Shasta and Senta, who are my sisters. They get me in the back of the truck and they're showing me a photo album. Everyone's just like trying to go, you belong here. Where have you been? We've been waiting for you. We get into town and my dad's at the post office and she goes, well, I guess it's like she was so casual about the whole thing. Like, this is your father. It was my birthday. I didn't know. We didn't celebrate birthdays in the Shiva Lilas, and so the whole community kind of came together, and it was like, celebrated my birthday. I was really excited, and I asked like 3 days later if I could stay.
Yeah, it was absolutely seamless. It was absolutely seamless. It was wonderful. It was wonderful. It was one of the more wonderful things that I'd never really sat and analyzed. It was such a casual reintroduction, and it just happened so that it was, you know, a week later, it was like it had never been any different than that, really.
I was like, okay. Done with that phase of my life and walked into a whole nether world where we were more or less nuclear, well, more or less, a hippie nuclear family. I mean, I had a dad and I was adopted by Creek's wife, Betty Ann, who's now my mom and has been since I was 9. And I got a brother and learned about sibling rivalry and Christmas and holidays. And I got American life back.
Boy, the Shiva Lila experience was something. We all made a great big bed up in the loft of the workshop, and we slept together for about 2 months just because we didn't want to get that far away from each other. We were pretty shaken up by the experience. I think at some point I stopped trying to figure out what Black Bear meant to me. It was so intense, and it was so much a part of my identity that I think I just really had to let go of it. I've had sadness and grief over not having a child, a blood child, and not having some kind of a life partner that I really shared something with.
You do that,
And I just wasn't sure where to go from there. And it had never occurred to me to do law. Doing law was a way to, you know, fight the system in some way. Yeah, that's it. That's it. This document basically says that it's going to remain open communal land in perpetuity. Can't sell it. Can't divide it up into condominiums. You can't, you know, clear cut it and level it and make a miniature golf course. I mean, it's, you know, there's very little that you can do except live on it, more or less, the way we've lived on it, which is what we wanted, which is good.
So what do you think about all this?
Where'd you dig it up?
Really little.
His name is Osha, and Osha is the name of the plant that's closely related to him.
Something personal that I want to do, because I did it, I used to do it all over here, and there were lots of things we all used to do all over here. But this is one thing I used to do, and it was good for me. And I used to just holler. I'll holler right here. Blessed am I! Freedom am I. I am the infinite within my soul. I can find no beginning. I can find no end. Oh, this I am. That's about the way I feel it.
Hey, Dave.
Yeah.
You decent?
It's like you go from your mother's womb into the grave. In between is life. And you can see it as a continuous flame, or you can see, understand that what it really is, when you burn a candle, you don't, it's not the same candle burning. Every instant that it burns, it's a new candle. The old candle is gone, it's burnt, it's died. Let me check out here. I want to see what the flowers are doing here.
I think it's fine. Huh? Oh, good. I'm glad you liked it.
Goodness, it's all about you. You're a good-looking babe. Proud to be an elder.
Having an operation helps.
We're here today to honor Richard's name.
This one looks like the Allen Ginsberg years in the 50s.
So we're starting with our traditional black bear ritual, which is to stand in this formation that lets us all see each other.
Boundless universe.
60s lingerie. I don't know. Oh yeah, that's an old one.
All right, take two.
Okay.
All right, here comes the Polish army. Fear, trembling. Cut.
Dandelion root here. Oh, somewhere. There it is.
I would say don't give in to fear. There's nothing to fear. We're gonna, you know, life comes and goes. So when you look back, you know, you could say, well, I used to work for Chase Manhattan Bank, but now I take care of horses, or I deliver babies, or I, you know, I can give people counsel or whatever.
Everybody's smiling, loving each other. Mountains are laughing, sister.
This is all right to put in the documentary with me. You're so welcome.
New way going down, new day coming. I hear it ringing.
So I really am that person.
I fully believe that you are who you are. I never doubted it for a moment.
That's good. Keep us honest.
Turn on.
Thank you.
Thank you.